The first people to spot the Russian invasion of Ukraine were actually on the other side of the globe. Before Putin had ever said anything about his assault, a group of academics in California noticed an unusual buildup of traffic at the border and concluded correctly that the invasion had begun. How did they do it? Using satellite technology. 6 months ago, I left active duty with the Marine Corps and joined a defense technology startup in Washington, D.C. I was surprised when they asked me to help build a military space strategy. I didn't know anything about space. I could barely tell you the difference between Star Wars and Star Trek. I did want to be an astronaut as a kid, but if you're afraid of roller coasters, you're probably scared of rocket ships too. I did learn that summer that for the US, space is considered the ultimate high ground. And as a result, we've already militarized it quite a bit. Above us right now, there are enough satellites to take a picture of every square meter of the planet multiple times a day. In 2023, the US is planning to field a space-based laser. That's next year. But guess who else is militarizing space? Russia and China. As a Marine officer, I can tell you, we're in a dead sprint, and no one is settling for a second. But here's what concerns me. Using space to find better ways to kill each other is easy. What's harder is using space constructively to lift all boats and not just deepen great power competition. Space is supposed to be the final frontier. So is militarizing the hell out of it the best that we can do? Maybe there's a better way. This past quarter, I took a class called Climate Ventures, where I teamed up with aeronautics and astronautics students to explore ways that space technology can solve climate change. During our research, I found this really interesting company called GHGSat. They're using satellite-based radar technology to visually identify methane emissions across the planet. The first time we've ever been able to do that. Another company, another approach, sponsored by Harvard University and backed by Bill Gates, uses a different approach. They use space technology to spray fine particles into the upper atmosphere and scatter sunlight and actually cause global cooling. That would be a game changer for global warming. But climate change is just an example. I think that space technology has the ability to solve many problems in many industries for the benefit of all of us. And it would be great if commercial space was on par with military space. But there's two problems with that. First, though space is technically infinite, we're actually running out of it really fast. Between 90 to 600 miles above the planet is a sweet spot where 90% of satellites have been deployed. We call this low Earth orbit, or LEO. 90 to 600 miles sounds like a lot, but in LEO, satellites don't sit still. They actually move and orbit. So instead of picturing a dot that surrounds the planet, you should actually picture a ring that goes around it instead. In 2021, the UN estimated that there were 7,500 satellites in LEO. That's a lot of rings. It creates a real traffic jam, or in this case, a space jam. What makes it more complicated is that when satellites collide with each other, or when they reach the end of their useful life, they actually get stuck because we don't yet know how to remove space debris. So, when broken satellites and debris are in space in LEO, they create a higher likelihood for more accidents, which creates more debris. and it's a vicious cycle. It's hard to tell how much space is left in Leo, but we're definitely running out. This leads to the second problem. Because space technology is so expensive, defense has an outsized voice in how commercial space dollars are being spent. Sure, SpaceX is a $100 billion company, but when the government is spending $54 billion on space per year, it's hard to ignore them in your business case. Military organizations like Space Force and the National Reconnaissance Office are also outsourcing their space technology to the commercial sector. So even though it looks like a lot of money is flowing into the commercial sector, into commercial space, it's often just a Trojan horse for more military spending. Personally, I completely understand why the US is rushing to militarize space. And if I'm being honest, I understand why Russia and China are doing the same. But great power competition doesn't benefit humanity. What benefits humanity in space is combating climate change, or frankly, any use of commercial space. So I'm here to sound the alarm. The world's militaries are filling space up fast, and the opportunity to shift the trajectory of the space industry is shrinking. So what now? If you're someone whose relationship with space is primarily just watching Guardians of the Galaxy, you still have a very important role to play. We need to demonstrate both an awareness of and a demand for commercial uses of space technology. And not just for climate change, but also for agriculture, finance, urban studies, maritime activity, and even politics. Space technology has come so far, but unless you're in the military, you probably don't know about it. But now that you all do, you can help amplify the demand for commercial space technology. Start by exploring the imagery that's been collected by satellite companies. Any Stanford student has access to the historical database of Planet, one of the largest space companies with nearly 500 satellites in low Earth orbit in LEO, and data going back to 1972. I challenge you all to use this data and show us something constructive that you can build with space technology. Planet's historical database is available to MIT and ASU students as well, but I urge Planet and all satellite imagery companies to make their data available to everyone and open source. Imagine the scientific doors that we could collectively unlock. By demonstrating a groundswell of demand and finding novel ways to use space technology that no one has ever seen before, you can help ensure that the future direction of the space industry is equally influenced by commercial needs as well as military needs, and avoid the over-militarization of space. I'll leave you with one last story. 2 days ago, Russia severed the internet in Ukraine, a classic military move to disable your opponent's command and control. It looked like a crippling blow, but within 24 hours, Elon Musk announced that Starlink, a satellite-based internet service provider, would now be online in the Ukraine for the first time. Picture that. Space, not just an extension of our earthly conflicts, but instead a solution for them, a way to resolve what we're doing to each other here. That is the power of space. Thank you.